I'm John Batchelor. This is the John Batchelor Show. It's a great pleasure to welcome the author, Steve Coll. He is also a dean of Columbia Journalism School and a veteran newspaper reporter, and he puts all those skills together for Director at S, which would be a horror story except for the fact that it's unfinished. So right now, this is fresh reporting, very carefully, about the Afghanistan conflict since the attack on New York and Washington, September 11th, 2001. Steve's previous book, Ghost Wars, dealt with the prior period of conflict in Afghanistan and ended just before the attack. So this is the rest of the story, but not quite. February 1989, the Soviet 40th Army withdraws from Afghanistan without victory. December 2014, the American, representing most of the ISAF forces, withdraws from Afghanistan without victory. Inside those 25 years is the tale. Steve, congratulations, and an overwhelming story. I've lived it on the radio, and it's a great treat to see behind the scenes I couldn't on the day-to-day reporting. And the footwork here is overwhelming, so I apologize to your family as well for taking you back over it. However, I want to begin with a scene to September 13th, 2001, in the basement, I get the feeling we're below the garages, of the CIA building in Langley, Virginia, the Counterterrorism Center. The boss is Kofor Black, and a psychologist, you report to us, comes to Kofor Black and says, "The people need your voice. You're their father to them. They're upset, they're rattled, they're blamed, they're working hard. Speak to them." Who is Kofor Black? What does he say? And what is the Counterterrorism Center so overwhelmed with the attack on America? Good evening to you.
Good evening. Thank you so much for having me. Well, the counterterrorist, I think it was called at that time, the Counterterrorist Center at CIA, was responsible for chasing terrorists all over the world. It had one unit focused on Al-Qaeda, and they had been warning all summer that something bad was coming. They didn't know when and where. Kofor Black was the director of the center, a career CIA operations officer who had served in Africa as well as other places. One of his earlier assignments had been to chase bin Laden when he lived in Sudan, so he knew very well what he was up against. And he was responsible for hundreds of analysts and operators in that headquarters building, and they were rattled. They had felt overwhelmed and worried before the attacks, and then they felt angry and guilty and uncertain about what was coming next after the attacks. And so he asked the psychologist to take the temperature of the room and give him some advice, and she said, "Well, these are mostly analysts, they're not the kinds of operators that you're used to talking to. Don't use your into the jaws of hell speech or your football locker room speech. Speak to them a little more broadly and reassuringly." And so he went and addressed the workforce and said, "You know, be good to each other, because this is going to be a long war. We're going to take some losses." He was worried that a dozen or more of the people in the room would perish in the coming conflict. And so he wanted to prepare the group for those losses, but also to encourage them to hang together and to have courage. And so he told them what he'd been doing recently with President Bush, how President Bush had given him a nickname, Heifer, because he couldn't remember Kofor, and Kofor was kind of a large guy. Told them that his favorite movie was Bill and Ted's Excellent Adventure. Some of the workforce were crying, listening to his forecast of losses to come, but everyone laughed at that. And then he concluded by saying, "I want you to remember one thing. We're the good guys, and we're going to win."
Yes, if you remember one thing from this, I'd like it to be that we're the good guys and we're going to win. Carefully now, we begin with the scene at the CIA, because Steve's book is entitled Directorate S, and the subtitle is The CIA and America's Secret Wars in Afghanistan and Pakistan. So we begin in the CIA because there is another large player out there that is unseen at this moment by those of us reporting on the war, but that's why Steve's book is so rich. He takes us behind the scenes. So somewhere in Rawalpindi which is the subset of Pakistan where the state within a state, the Pakistani army, abides. Somewhere in Rawalpindi is a building which is called the ISI, the Inner Services Intelligence Services, and this is the CIA equivalent for Pakistan, and somewhere within ISI is Directorate S. So we don't know what they were saying at this time, but we have to establish the relationship between these two. They know about each other. You wrote about them in Ghost Wars. What does the CIA make of ISI and Directorate S? What does ISI and Directorate S make of the CIA at this moment?
Well, they had been partners. Really, the power of ISI and the significance of its covert action arm, which is what Directorate S is, really goes back to the 1980s when the CIA and Saudi intelligence collaborated with the Pakistanis to arm and fund the Afghan Mujahideen against the Soviet occupation. And the scale of aid they provided, hundreds of millions of dollars, had Directorate S grow into a state within the Pakistani state. Now, after the Americans left that conflict during the 1990s in the run-up to the attacks, ISI continued down this path. It continued to see the benefit to Pakistan of funding radical Islamist militias in order to thwart India. And a lot of their motivation involved their rivalry with India. But they also felt increasingly betrayed and angry at the United States because they felt the United States had used them during the Soviet war and then abandoned them. We imposed sanctions on Pakistan during the 1990s over its nuclear program. And so on the eve of 9/11, or in the aftermath of the attacks, Directorate S, I think, was of two minds. Their most important client in the region was the Taliban, who they had built up into the rulers of Afghanistan. Though they were isolated internationally, they were still making sure that Pakistan's neighboring country was controlled by a friendly force. And at the same time, they could see that the United States was going to retaliate for the 9/11 attacks, and they didn't want to be the target of that war. So they had to go through their own decision-making in the days after 9/11. In response to the Bush administration's, you know, famous question, are you with us or against us? And it was difficult for them to say, we're with you, but they did eventually decide they had no choice. But it was always a reluctant realignment with the United States. And as the years passed, they went back to the same kinds of operations that the CIA knew well from the 1980s.
So we have two competing secret forces, both of whom depend upon each other because there's now a mission. And the mission is Al-Qaeda. And again, Steve's very careful recitation of all these facts weaves in Al-Qaeda, although there's always this question mark about whether or not the ISI is part of Al-Qaeda or related to Al-Qaeda, and whether the U.S. knows that or cares to use that advantage. This will become more important as the years go by, but at this moment, you call it a devil's deal. The U.S. is committed to getting Al-Qaeda, though it knows that the Taliban is going to be in the way. That's the devil's
yes.
deal. And we're going to pretend, or at least maintain, the idea that we can get in, get Al-Qaeda, and get out.
Yes. And from the very first week or two, when the Bush administration started to speak in public about what it intended to do, this problem of the Taliban surfaces when you go back and look at the president's remarks to Congress, for example. The president doesn't say right away, we're going to go to war with the Taliban, because there were no Afghans on those planes. They knew that this was an Al-Qaeda attack, and the Taliban were a much more formidable, embedded, indigenous force than Al-Qaeda, which consisted of Arabs and Chechens and Uzbeks in the thousands, but not native to Afghanistan. And so from the very beginning, the Bush administration said, you know what, Mr. Taliban, if you will turn these guys over to us and tear down their training camps and cooperate with the international community, you have a chance to get out of the way. But the Taliban's leader, Mullah Muhammad Omar, in his councils with his own advisors, told them, and they urged him, you know, look, you can't defeat the United States. You will lose your government. And many of his advisors urged him to cooperate and turn over bin Laden. What's he to us, they said. And Mullah Muhammad Omar said, well, I cannot deliver a fellow Muslim to American justice. I would be violating God's will if I did that. And if we have to lose our government, then it's God telling us that we weren't doing it right. And And so the war began, but in a state of ambiguity about whether the Taliban were an enemy of the United States.
The book is directed at the CIA and America's secret war in Afghanistan and Pakistan. Steve Coll is the author. When we come back, the war begins, and right away, the tensions are, who is the enemy? I'm John Batchelor. This is the John Batchelor Show.